Well,
Hi, Chelsea.
how are you?
Don't ask. Difficult week.
Yeah.
Yeah. I need a new roof.
What's that?
I need a new roof.
Oh no, that's not fun.
No, that's expensive.
Yes, we
Yeah.
had to, we're first time homeowners and we had to get our roof replaced last summer, so I feel your pain.
Yeah. I don't think our roof has been done in about the last 40 years, so it did need doing. But yeah, we've got the bill, and it's like, oh my God, that's a lot of money.
Oh, that's a bummer.
Yeah. I have to say, I've been very lax this week. So
I'm moving at a snail's pace getting through this because it's just so still counterintuitive to me. It takes me a long time to go through even the simple examples. I'm hoping that it's worth this like startup cost, you know, and then it will go a little smoother in weeks to come. But yeah, I didn't even get through all of chapter two. I'm still stuck on the first like 5 or 6 pages of the basic intro to conditional probability problems.
yeah. I've been having a look at your question.
What's that?
I've been after. Oh, it doesn't come up when I put the when I hold the book up. But anyway, I'm having a look at the book now, and I'm having a look at your question.
Oh, I figured out my first question, and I think I kind of figured out the second one too. It's just not intuitive to me.
No, it's not
Like,
intuitive to anyone, I don't think.
my brain just wants to apply the formula and not think about the logic at all. I just want to plug it in, and you can't do that. You have to think through the context quite a bit. So, yeah. No, I think I figured out the first one, and we can maybe go through that one today if we have time. But I included a little bit of recap because I don't think we talked about inclusion exclusion at all yet in these book in their meetings.
We could probably do some more on that. Yeah.
Yeah, so yeah, I have a couple slides of recap and then going through like the main problem that illustrates inclusion exclusion, which is that like matching card problem. I don't know if you read through that one at all. That one broke my brain at
The game show
first.
one.
Huh?
The game show one.
It was called like DeMontmort's
No,
matching
that's a different
problem.
one I'm thinking of. No.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, well, I don't.
There is a
Oh.
game show one in here, actually.
Yeah, I decided to buy the book. I'm having a hard time reading it on my screen as well. So I think hopefully that will help me move through it faster too. So I ordered it today and we'll see when it comes. Also, looks like maybe we don't have anybody joining. So I guess I'll just start.
Yeah, there was someone who was thinking about it, but
Then
because they committed
they thought
them.
better of it.
Yeah, then they sought medical attention for because they hit their head and they recovered. So yeah,
Yeah,
yeah.
pretty much. Let me make sure I rendered the latest version of my code. I'm like working up on this like down to the wire, trying to like get through it, but it's just, yeah. That's why we're here, I suppose. Okay, I will go ahead and just start sharing. And I only have 15 slides. And again, like even though today was supposed to be covering the material, you can't really get through the material without understanding how to apply the formulas. So it just takes as long as it takes. So we can talk at the end about like the plan for next week, I guess.
Cool.
Okay, can you see my screen?
Yes.
Awesome.
Introduction to conditional probability, chapter two.
Yep. Yes. But first we'll go through some concepts from chapter one that I think we kind of missed talking about together.
Yeah.
The main thing being this inclusion exclusion idea, and then this kind of representative example called DeMontmort's problem that's in the textbook. So the idea of inclusion exclusion, to my understanding, is just that if you want to basically compute the union of, you know, a set of events,
Yeah.
if you just add them up together individually, you're actually going to be double counting
Yes. Yeah.
the region that they intersect. So it's really easy to visualize with just two or three different events where you have to add them together, but then you subtract the intersection. And then, shown on the right, like you add up the individual ones, subtract the intersections between each pair, but then actually you've removed this middle one. So you actually have to add back the triple intersection later. So the more events that you have, the more complicated that gets to be.
That could get very complicated, couldn't it, really?
Yes. So if you want, sorry, that didn't fit all in one slide, but for the Venn diagram on the right here with three different events, you can imagine that if you want the union of all three, you want just this shape without all the lines in the middle of it. If you add A, B, and C, and then you remove A intersection C, this little football shape, and then you remove this football shape, and you remove this football shape, you have omitted this middle section entirely because you added those sections three times and then you subtracted them three times. So you got to add this one back. And so that's given by this long formula here. And then for any N subsets, if you want the union of any N different subsets, the pattern again is like kind of complicated, but it can be given by this formula here. So it's the sum of all the individual events.
Yeah.
And then you subtract the pairwise events. Yeah. And so then you add back the, all the different combinations that there could possibly be. So it gets really complicated. And I almost kind of think it might be worth going through one with four just to make sure that we can understand and employ this pattern intuitively. Yeah. But nobody's got time for that. So maybe one day in a later chapter, we will actually practice one with four, because
someone will invent an artificial intelligence will be able to do it before we can crack the code, I think.
I guess I should maybe ask ChatGPT for help on some of this. I haven't done that yet because I'm a little bit reluctant to give up on my own.
I did ask it once and it came back with a 426% probability on something. So that wasn't right.
No,
it will give you an answer. Not right. It will give you an answer, but it won't necessarily be right.
Okay, noted. Yeah, not going to trust that guy yet.
but I think some stuff I've put into it and it has come back right, and I think it's right. Because I'll try and work it out myself, and then I thought, I'm not sure about this. I'll put it into ChatGPT and see if it's the same. If it thinks the same as I do, well, we could both be wrong, but we might be both right. I'm kind of hoping that that's the situation.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, sometimes it'll give a screwy answer, which is definitely not right.
Mm-hmm. So this is kind of a really good but kind of complicated and at first counterintuitive example of how to implement this idea of inclusion-exclusion to calculate probability. So the problem posed by this, statistical philosopher back hundreds of years ago was, if you have a well-shuffled deck of cards and you're playing the world's most boring game where you flip a card one at a time and you say aloud the number of the flip that you're on, 1, 2, 3, what's the probability that you get at least one match between the number that you say and the number that appears on the card if the cards are numbered 1 through n? So before we can set up the problem, it's helpful to think about what type of sampling problem is this? We had that little sampling table that we talked about last time. So the first question is, does the order matter? And yes, for this one, thankfully, that's intuitive. That's kind of the point of this problem. The order that they appear in does matter. So we're looking at a permutation. Are we replacing the cards as we flip? No, we are not. So this is a permutation without replacement problem. And if you're like me and don't remember the formulas off the top of your head and don't quite have intuition, it's just the total number of possible permutations is n factorial. Because if you flip one card, it can have n possible values. You flip the next one, it can have n minus 1, n minus 2. So when you talk it through that way, it's like, oh yeah, that makes sense. But
so 52 times 51 times 50 times 49 times 48, that's going to be a big number.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So I found it really helpful to go through this example with I just literally drew out three boxes, and those being the cards, and then I kind of numbered 1, 2, 3 above them. I was like, okay, well, what's the probability that if we had a deck of, let's say, and on this slide I guess I wrote 5 cards, what's the probability that any one of those cards is in the right place? So if we think about, for any of the i cards, any of the, you know, one through n cards, if it's a fair deck, then it has one over n possible places that it could be, right? Like, has a one in n chance of being a match. So what's the probability? And I guess maybe I should have written out the full math for this here. I did skip a few steps in this. So like, if we wanted to say like, well, what's this probability? Because we just said on the previous slide that there's n factorial total permutations for the deck of cards, right? So for a deck of three cards, that's 3 × 2 × 1 or 6. And then, you know, it gets obviously like a lot bigger, a lot quicker. So for any individual card to be in that position, it's 1/n, but that's not including where are the rest of the cards then for that to match, right? So in order to compute that, and I have to go back to my cheat sheet here to make sure that I'm explaining this correctly. We could choose any of the n cards to be a match, right?
Yeah.
So that would be like n choose one, right?
Yeah.
And then we just multiply that by the number, by the probability of that match occurring. So it'd be, go back to my cheat sheet here. I wrote it just yesterday to make sure I understood this. It's like n choose one multiplied by where could all the rest of the cards be? What's the number of possible outcomes? So we've just chosen one to be a match. So that means that there's n minus one factorial possible permutations for the remaining cards, divided by n factorial total possible outcomes of the whole deck, right?
Yeah.
So sorry, I should have like written this out in this nomenclature here, but imagine that this just says n choose one, n minus one factorial over n factorial. And so if you do that math, n choose one is just n. There's n, you could choose any of the n cards to be in the right place. And then n minus one factorial over n factorial simplifies to 1/n. And so you just get n times 1/n, which is one. So that would be our first value.
So yeah, if it's one divided by n and n is five cards, does that make it 0.2?
Sorry, say it again.
If it's one divided by n and n is five cards, is that a probability of 0.2? So one divided by five.
For any card to be a match, yeah. So, but now that's just like looking at one card. So, but we have to think like, what's the probability of there being any number of matches?
Yeah.
But we can step through and say like, okay, like, because we have to follow this inclusion exclusion formula to get there, right? Because we want the union. Like, we could have one match, we could have two. It could be cards 1 and 3 that match, or it could be cards 1 and 5 that match, and we don't know. So we have to total up all the different permutations that include a match of two cards, match of three cards, match of four cards, add all those up and then subtract the intersections. And so if we follow that logic through, okay, let's say we've got any two cards, right?
Yeah.
We're just going to choose two of them at random to be a match. We don't care what their arrangement is. So that's the n choose two part of this. Those two are going to be a match. And then we're going to multiply that by probability of the rest of them can be in any position at all. So we chose the first one can be the first one we've chosen the n minus one value.
Yeah.
Those two are the matches. So the other ones can be in any arrangement. And how many possible ways are there to do that? Well, there's n minus two can be anywhere. N minus three can be anything, n minus four and so on. So that simplifies to n minus two factorial. And then there were, again, an n factorial total number of outcomes possible for the whole deck to begin with. So if we expand out from this, like, you know, n choose k formula that we have, and we plug in the values, it's n factorial over n minus k factorial times k factorial. And then this, if we write it out, it simplifies to 1 over n times n minus 1. Because if you imagine n times n minus 1 times n minus 2 factorial, the n minus 2 factorial cancels out. And you're left with this. And then this, if we go on to simplify it a little bit, we can imagine that it's saying n times n minus 1 times... I find it helpful to write this out because sometimes I like forget what can cancel. So if we write it out a little bit and expand it, we can see, oh yeah, sweet. We can cancel out the n minus 2 factorial here. And then if we're multiplying these two things together, the n times n minus 1 cancel between the numerator and denominator here. And we're left with 1 over 2 factorial. So that's the probability that any two cards match in this deck. So what if we have three?
Yeah.
It gets more complicated again. But I feel like once you figured out that basic, it's not basic. It's not intuitive. It's, but like, it's once not you basic, no. Yeah, once you figure out, like, oh, like, that's what this n choose 3 means here. And it took me a while to get that in the textbook explanation of, like, what that was. This is the number of arrangements that you can, like, this is how many different ways there are to choose 3. And then this is the probability that those 3 are, you know, the value that they should, that they match. So n choose 3, you know, you plug it into the n choose k formula, and then the same thing here. If you've chosen 3 to be one value, then the n minus 3 factorial remaining cards out of an n factorial total number of configurations is the probability. So then again, if you multiply all this out, you get 1 over 3 factorial. And just by doing the choose one card, choose two cards. Sorry?
It's 1/6 then? So, As n increases, we recognize the pattern emerging. That looks a heck of a lot like the Taylor series for 1 over E.
Ooh. Which I wouldn't have really recalled that from, I don't even know if I ever learned how to do a Taylor series before, but Khan Academy refreshed my memory on what it is and how you use it. And it's apparently one of these patterns that is going to come back more and more. So I thought it was worthwhile to go through this. Mm-hmm. And it kind of makes sense once you think about what this is saying, because I think, like, you might think, like, well, the more cards that I have in the deck, the more likely I am to have a match. I have more options. But that also means for each card, you have a lower probability of getting the right match because it's 1 over n. So you don't get a probability that approaches 1 or approaches 0, it approaches 1 over E, which is kind of like a weird number, but it's kind of like, I'm trying to like relate it intuitively to exponential growth that E is. And it's like, as the deck grows, your probability shrinks. So you're inversely proportional to, I don't know, it's like, close to being intuitive at this point, but I'm not quite there. But
I forget the E number. It's 2 point something, isn't it?
Yes.
Yeah. Just don't ask me what that 2 point something is.
It's basically the, like, imagine you have like a dollar.
Yeah,
if you have a dollar and you invest it and you're getting interest on that dollar.
It's the compound interest thing, isn't it? I think
it's the maximum rate of compound interest that you can get if you compound like in infinitesimally small intervals. So it's like, it's the limit of 1 + 1/n to the n as n approaches infinity. There is like a really helpful tutorial, like explanation of E and where it came from on, there's a website called Better Explained that tries to break down kind of complicated math ideas. And there's a really good one on E and like, well, why do we use E as a root then? Like, why do we use it in the natural logarithm? And so it goes through like how, you know, an intuitive way to think about what E is. And then Yeah, it makes sense to use it as a base then, because if it's like the limit, that's the maximum amount that we can get, then every situation of exponential growth could be viewed as some decrement of E, right? Like some proportion of E. So if we raise E to that power, it kind of can be used to model those different things. Yeah. But yeah, how it relates to probability is kind of like, I'm like, I can't quite like put my finger completely on it and be like, aha, yes, I get this fully and entirely and I can explain it. But it like sort of makes sense. Like,
yeah,
the number is growing at the same time that your probability is decreasing. So yeah.
Cool.
Okay, so that's.
Yeah, I don't know how his name's pronounced. Is it Euler or Euler? I think it's Euler.
Euler.
Euler, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I'm learning some digital signal processing too for my work and trying to understand, like, oh, what's it called? Like it's, you know, relating complex number. It's got, you know, there's like e to the ik. I'm like, holy crap, like there's pi and e and I all in the same formula and I'm supposed to understand how this came about. It's very complicated. Okay, so finally to some chapter two content, which seems like it's so straightforward and it makes sense until you actually try to solve a problem with it, even a simple problem. So I think it's just going to be about like taking the time to be like, okay, what does it mean if we have this situation and really break it down? And then it will become more instinctive over time. So conditional probability is realistically what all probability is. Like we don't ever have probability that is just totally immutable and doesn't depend on other things that have happened. It changes depending on other events that have happened. So it explicitly addresses
the statistics, he says, isn't it?
What's that?
Yeah, he says it's the soul of statistics.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yep. So he gives this example in the book. If you let P of R indicate the probability of rain before you've looked outside, you know, you might say like, oh, there's like a 50-50 chance or whatever. But if after looking outside, we see like ominous clouds and high winds, we might change our expectation of how likely it is to rain given that new information. So the nomenclature for this is, oh, it didn't like that. My little vertical line is missing here, but we put a little vertical line between the two things and that is read as the probability of R given C, like given some other event that has happened. And this is called conditioning on C. And so that conditioning gives you new information and informs how you might change the probability of the first event occurring. So
could I just say, this week I did go outside, I checked the weather forecast, it said a 10% probability of rain. I went outside and I'm not even making this up, the clouds did look kind of like a little bit blowy, but I thought I'd be all right, and I have to say it did rain quite a lot.
I've learned not to trust the forecast here in Phoenix. It said like 40% chance of rain all weekend and we didn't get a single drop. So
Arizona is supposed to be really hot, isn't it?
Yeah, it's miserable.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So here's kind of more, you know, formulas of how we can compute probability of event A given probability of event B. So formally and mathematically, it's defined as this. So probability of A given B is given by the probability of the intersection of A and B over the probability of B. And it's important to note that P of A given B is not inherently going to be the same thing as probability of B given A. There's not symmetry there. And that kind of makes sense. I think there is an example that I gave here. Yeah. This is just a representative example of how these two things are not necessarily the same. So if you draw two cards from a standard deck of cards, one at a time without replacement, let A be the event that the first card is a heart and B be the event that the second card is red. So find A given B and B given A. So because all four suits are equally likely, the probability of A, that the first card is a heart, you've got a 1 in 4 chance of getting that. After a heart is selected, there's 51 cards that remain, right? And so of those, 25 are red because you've pulled one of the red ones already with your heart. So therefore, probability of B is 25 over 51. So when we want to compute the intersection, and this is where I got tripped up in the question that I posted on Slack, this intersection is not just a straightforward multiplication of the individual probabilities in isolation. You have to change your sample space depending on whether an event has occurred. So, and we kind of did that already here in computing probability of B, because we're not choosing from 52 cards anymore. We're choosing out of 51, and there's only 25 possibilities. So we can multiply them together after we've taken into account that this is not just, oh, well, we've got 50-50 chance of choosing a red card because our sample space has changed. So if we multiply those together, we get the probability of the intersection, and that's 25 out of 204.
Yeah, we know that we're doing really advanced probability because the answers aren't a half or a quarter.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So let's see, why did I go through this? Oh, because to calculate probability of A given B, we have to know the intersection, but we also have to know the probability of B. So this is where it gets a little confusing. Like, to implement this formula correctly, you need to know that, like, when the probability is contingent on a different event. So here, our sample space was adjusted for the fact that we were drawing out of 51 cards.
Yeah.
But if we don't know in advance the value of the first card, we conclude that the second card has a 50-50 chance of being red or black. So this part's like still a little bit confusing to me, because you know that it's going to be the second card that's drawn. So I guess I was a little unsure of, like.
So it's basically saying, I think, that we kind of have to suspend our knowledge a bit on it. Because the intersection of A and B isn't the same probability as, sorry, B in the intersection of A and B isn't the same as the probability of B. Because if B's a half, the B in the intersection of A and B is a little bit less than a half, because we know what the result of A is.
Yes. Yeah, so this one, when you're computing the intersection, exactly, you have to assume that A has occurred. But if you're just saying, like, okay, I don't know what the first card was, and I'm going to choose the second card, what's the possibility that it's red or black? Mm. I guess I'm a little unsure, like, because you're not sampling out of 52 cards anymore, it's out of 51. So in order to get a clean 1/2 probability, you'd have to have a, like, decimal point up here, which is not possible. So I'm like a little bit confused on, like, what are the actual number of possibilities? But yeah, so this part's like a little bit unclear to me, and maybe we should, like, ask for clarification. But just intuitively, if you think about it, it's like, well, it's 50-50. I don't know what the first one was. And in the text, he kind of talks a little bit about how, like, well, we know that it's happening temporally, right, in a sequence, but for the purpose of solving the problem, the order doesn't matter. And I'm like, but it does. Like, you're only choosing from 51 in reality. So, like,
I think
some more breakdown of this would be helpful, but, like, we're supposed to understand that it should be 50-50. So to plug in these values that we partially understand how we came about into our nice little formula, we computed the probability of the intersection, which was 25 over 104 or 204, and the probability of B, if you don't know that whether or not A has occurred, is 1/2. And that gives a total of 25 over 102. And then just to show that, you know, probability of A given B is not necessarily the same thing as probability of B given A, we compute that here. And so this is the formula for that. So we compute the intersection. The intersection is symmetric. Although that's a little confusing too. I kind of want to think through that probability of E being. Yeah, this is one property that I guess is like always symmetric, even if you're talking about conditional probability. I don't think he really like talked through exactly why. But apparently it is symmetric and it's the same.
Mm-hmm.
But now we have to divide that over the probability of A, which is 1/4. And so we can see that this is more likely than this one. Yeah, I think I'm trying to still like think through like probability that the first card is a heart, given that the second card was red. Yeah, it doesn't really make any sense, like sense to me why it would be less likely than the reverse, but it is according to the maths.
You see, the thing is, we don't know enough to argue with the math, do we? Really?
No. Yeah. Anyway, even these simple examples are like, maybe it's best to like not think too hard about it and just like accept a few things, but I have a hard time with that. So this made sense to me the other day, but now I've kind of like, yeah, the probability of B being 1/2. That's the part that's a little confusing to me.
I remember seeing a maths documentary about a University of Oxford professor who'd kind of like won a maths Nobel Prize or something like that. I mean, and basically it was a story of him sitting in a room for 7 years thinking about something. And it's like,
how do you not go just absolutely crazy?
Yeah.
Anyway, so like that one is still slightly breaking my brain, but I find that this diagram in the book was really helpful for me. I still don't implement it as I should automatically, but I think the like forcing ourselves to return to this idea will help us in computing what's the intersection. Yeah. So if we you know, have this simple example here and we have a total number of outcomes, and now we want to look at like what's the conditional probability of these different things happening. So let's talk about the conditional probability of something in A happening given that some outcome in B happened. So if we know that B happened, then we don't have 9 total outcomes anymore. We have 4 because we know that B happened. So we get rid of B complement from our sample. Everything that's not in B.
All the other 5.
We get rid of them. And so you can see that like now we're left with a different number of total possible outcomes that intersect A and B. Although it happens to be the same. Like I guess like there's 1 possibility out of 9 here. But once we know that B has happened, now there's 1 possibility out of 4. So now it's a different number of possible outcomes. And so that influences the probability that you get of A intersection B.
Renormalize it. It's a great word, isn't it, really?
Yeah. So because now our total number of outcomes is shifted, we, instead of dividing by 9 here, we divide by 4 because that's the number of outcomes within B. So it kind of like helps break down the formula that we're using for A given B. It's the probability of the intersection in your new sample space divided by the probability of B. And so I guess like, Maybe the problem that we were confused on with the second card being red is a little bit like Schrodinger's box, right? You don't know, whether the first card was black or red. So for all purposes, it was black and red. So you still have a 50-50 chance on the next one. I think it's just like the math of like, you're actually drawing from 51 cards. That's the part that's throwing me. But yeah, this is where like just blindly putting things into the formula is formulas is not going to help us here. We have to like take the time to think through like, how does this knowledge have to be adapted to be
put in honestly, the way it's put into Pebble World with the lovely diagrams, it just makes intuitive sense. That mm-hmm. you just see that and you know what it is in a way that when you look at the formula, it's just kind of like, ooh, that kind of hurts my head a bit.
I'm trying to find examples of that,
but you just see the picture and it's like, oh, that makes sense.
Yeah, but we're going to get into more complicated examples where we can't draw out all the possibilities very soon. Yeah. So I'm trying to grasp it, you know, a little bit more abstractly so I don't have to draw it out every time. So from this formula, we have a few, you know, we can algebraically move some terms around in these formulas and get new theorems, and even though we've just like shifted terms around. But so if we do that from our starting formula, right, like we initially had this on the left-hand side and this was on top of the numerator, but if we just multiply both sides by probability of B, then this gets on top and now we have the probability of the intersection is given by probability of A given B times probability of B given of B. And then, you know, if we plug this in to the other one around, then we can say like, oh, then equating probability of A given B to B given A might be really helpful moving forward, because we already know that these are not going to be equal to each other. So I'm sure we're going to be asked to quantify them in many ways. And I just have a note here from the book. If A and B are independent, then probability of A given B is the same as probability of A, because conditioning on B does nothing. B has no effect on the probability of A. So that's like, it makes sense when you read it, but I know that that's something that would trip me up in a problem. So just thinking through, like, are these two things actually independent from one another? So if it is independent, then the conditional probability is going to be the same as the event just happening on its own, because B's not influencing A.
Yeah, it's a bit of a trick question, because the way it's set out is like the probability of A given B. Now we're going to assume, given that it's got given B in it, B's going to have some effect.
Right, yeah.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. But it may well not.
Yep. So Bayes' rule is just, again, still like moving some terms around from this first arrangement up here. Probability of A given B is given by probability of B given A times P of A over P of B. I didn't really get too far in the book and like reading through. He talks about how this is often rewritten in terms of the odds of an event happening. And odds is another thing that I don't understand intuitively. So I think some discussion of this next week at the start might be helpful, but I haven't had a chance to like read through this and how to think about odds versus probability.
It's basically one divided by the odds is the probability, basically.
Is it that simple?
Yeah, basically. So if it's one divided by four, then the probability is going to be 0.25.
I think I just get confused by the nomenclature of like the odds are 4-1 against or 3-1 for, you know, like that kind of terminology. So I think I'm going to have to wrestle with that. If you know it, we don't have to talk about it together, but I independently definitely need to think through the different ways that it's stated and like gambling problems and stuff. So
it's one of the few things that are relatively simple in that you've done stuff that's just incredibly harder than odds to probability.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
But yeah, you'll be fine with that.
Okay. And then the last slide I have, this is as far as I've made it in the chapter. It's only like 5 or 10 pages into the second chapter, but there's this law of total probability. So if you have, a sample space S, that's, comprised of a bunch of A sub N different events that are disjoint from each other such that their union totals S. Probability of some event B, right? Because if all A events comprise S, then B is technically a subset of the union, is a subset of the union of these things. But like, how do you determine like which parts go where? It's just summing up the individual intersections that B has with each A sub I. And so that's given by the summation here. I'm not sure exactly what that's going to be used for, but that's the diagram explaining it. So
it's probably going to be something fairly important, I think, but I'm not sure. I mean, it's not just kind of like law of a bit of probability. It says total probability. So it's more important than otherwise.
Yeah. Yep. Okay. So yeah, sorry I didn't get further in the chapter.
Don't worry, you've got further than me in the chapter, so it's absolutely fine.
Okay.
Do you want next week? Am I? Shall I go from 2.3? Questions related to 2.3 onwards.
Okay. Yeah, that sounds good.
Yeah. I'll have a crack at that.
Last week was technically like, if we're going to do 2 weeks per chapter now, which seems like it's probably going to be necessary. Last week was still about chapter one then. So we got one more week for chapter two.
Yeah.
I mean, if you have time to present next week, that'd be awesome.
Yeah. I've got to go up to the other end of the country and back again because I'm buying a bike. But yeah,
nice.
I'll fit it in somehow. Yes.
Okay. No worries if you can't. Like, I won't adjust it. If you need another week, we can delay because it's taking me a long time to go through it too.
I'm so impressed with your presentation today. I'm feeling feelings of shame and inadequacy. So I'm gonna pull something out of the bag next week to burnish my academic self-respect.
All right, cool.
Yeah, smashing. So I think John wants us to say what we're doing next week, so I'll put doing chapter two questions and I'll do
okay.
That.
Yeah, I'll take a look at the schedule and fill in. I have a couple weeks coming up where I probably won't be able to join, so I'll put that on there too. I have some travel coming up. So yeah, I'll put those dates there.
Yeah. No worries. Smashing. Cheers, Chelsea.
All right. Take care. Have a good one.
You too. Bye.